Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel, Deep Understanding of Research Papers. Today I will explain one paper called Exploring RNN Transducers. Sorry, there is a filling mistake. Transducers for Chinese speech recognition. This paper is a little bit old paper. I believe it came in 2017 or 18, and this is one of the idea people have used along with sequence to sequence algorithms. This RNN transducer is another algorithm, just like sequence to sequence model for any sequence transduction problem, right? And the authors are from some Chinese university and some few companies, collaboration between companies and universities. These are the authors, and the tutorial we are going to cover the overview of what is happening in this paper. Then we'll see what is recurrent neural network transducers, which are also known as RNNT, and we'll see the data set and some baseline models which they have used, and then we'll see some tricks they have used for efficient training. Then we'll see the model configuration of this paper, and then finally we'll see some experiments and results. So as I said, this paper introduces, but RNN transducers are algorithms. I mean, it's an algorithm which was developed before than this paper, but the idea was to take care of something called conditional independence problem in CTC. We'll see what is that, but this paper actually uses this kind of RNN model for Chinese speech recognition. I mean, you can apply it for any other, but they try it for speech recognition, Chinese one. That's why the name says Exploring RNN Transducer for Chinese Speech Recognition. They are just trying to see how these RNN transducers can be used for the training of speech recognition models. So RNN transducers are basically, I'll explain what they are in the coming slide in detail, but the RNN transducers are basically similar to any RNN CTC model you might have seen for any training of any sequence transduction problem, for example speech recognition and handwritten character recognition and so on. So this RNN with CTC has this problem of conditional independence assumption. Basically the idea is when you are predicting a output at time step t, the model basically assumes, the algorithm basically assumes, this yt prediction of current time steps output is conditionally independent of all other for any other t, right? So any other outputs, it won't take into consideration of this left context, right context or anything. That is the problem. It's not a problem, but that was the assumption. But usually, when you have any sequence transduction ideas or any sequence mapping problem, then you will need to know the history of the prediction. Basically you want to know what was the previous character so that the system can improve prediction of the current time steps output. So that was actually RNN transducer. We'll see the full architecture in the coming slide, and that is the idea of this paper, that they use these RNN transducers for speech recognition. Then they also introduce some new strategy for learning rate decay for accelerating the model convergence. So usually we face this problem when you're training any speech related application like language ID, speech recognition and so on. You will have this problem of model, I mean you will have this problem of convergence, because sometimes if you don't decay the learning rate, the model will go into some plateau stage. And also they have found some experiments to balance the GPU usage of GPU memory and training efficiency. We'll see this in the coming slides. And they get a character rate of 16.9% on the test data, which is basically 2% improvement over the baseline model. Baseline model is a simple BLSTM with cross entropy model. We'll see those things in detail. So yesterday actually I released one more video of explaining this same idea, but for some other application. Basically it's something which again uses RNN transducer. It was one of the famous paper by Google, released 2 months ago, I think. for joint training of speech recognition and speaker derivation, but they use the same RNN transducer. And in the old video, I have explained the RNN transducer in detail, but I am going to do the same thing here also. So basically, what we have is we have some encoder. The encoder could be any recurrent neural network. It could be a BLSTM or a BLSTM in combination with some convolutional neural network, and so on. So that is the encoder. So what happens is, if when you feed a input at time step t, this input could be some feature vector of let's say 40 dimension, basically extracted at time step t, right? So this, since we have usually when you have speech recognition, you have a sequence of audio and you'll get sequence of frames. So assume at some time step we feed this, and the encoder predicts some HT encoder, basically some hidden representation of the last layer's output, last layer's hidden activity at that particular time step. Then what I'm going to do is, I'm going to consider the previous prediction, which is called YU minus 1. So basically, this YU minus 1 is one of the character excluding the blank symbol. So usually when we are predicting output of the CTC, so basically we get output like this, H underscore underscore L underscore L underscore something like this, because we apply this mapping of the actual sequence of words into this pseudo sequence which has the length similar to the input. But anyway, so this is the kind of output we get, but the output YU minus 1 is one of the character from the previous time step, but not the underscore. So for example, let's say we are at this time step, we will not consider this, but we will consider this, right? So that is the YU minus 1. So that is why it's one of the character, it's a character of the previous prediction excluding the underscore, basically the blank symbol. So that goes as input to the prediction network. So prediction network is, so you can ask me, how are you going to feed this character into the prediction network? We are going to embed into one hot encoding, then we will apply an embedding layer on top of it and get the vector, which is the DINSS vector, and then feed it to again some LSTM. So that is what is happening in the prediction network. So the H prediction at that time step, you will get this another hidden activity HU prediction. So these two will go as input to the joint network, and joint network is just this network, so you can see here, and then you will predict the character at that particular time step. So you can see this thing as equations. So let's say you feed X, goes through the encoder, you get this thing. Then this YU minus 1 you already predicted from the previous time step, feed it to some embedding layer, and you get this embedding. Then feed it to the prediction layer, so that you get this prediction. Then you apply affine transformation for both H prediction and HT encoder and HT prediction with some bias, and then apply tarnish nonlinearity. Then you get this new hidden activity that goes as input to the softmax, and then you will be able to predict the probability score, all the characters of your vocabulary, or characters of probability of the one of the character given that particular time steps input and previous time steps output. And then you will train it with CTCs as usual. But this is how the entire thing works, right? So this is similar to the CTC, normal RNN CTC model, but the only thing is we have this new prediction network, and then we'll combine output from that prediction network with the current time steps hidden activity. Right, so this is how the RNN transducers works. So as simple as that. Now this paper, basically they have their own data set. I'll just tell you what is the data set and what it consists of. They have around 1,000 hours of Mandarin speech collected from their own voice interface, Sogu voice input method something on the mobile phones. And then they split the data into 50 hours of test data, validation data, and 950 hours of training data. And for the input, they use this 40 dimensional log filter bank energies with CMVN. So CMVN basically capsule mean variance normalization. So just a normalization technique people use, just like people use the normalization technique in images. And also to test the model's accuracy properly, they have also the noisy data set, which is around 70 hours of data. And as output, in the output, they have symbol inventory of 26 English character and Chinese characters of around 6,000, because number of characters in Chinese is very huge. They have around 40,000, I think, but the frequent ones are these ones. So they have used only those, and unknown symbol will be always used for unknown, and blank symbol will be used for CTC. Right? This is the symbol inventory. Symbol inventory is basically a dictionary, right? And coming to the baseline, for the baseline, they have used this four-layer BLSTM-based model with each layer having 256 cells. And they have used this optimization of cross-entropy loss for a tied phone state as a target. So basically, this is sort of like you first train one GMM, HMM, or a DNN HMM model. So basically, the idea of DNN HMM model is to assume some DNN HMM model will give you the alignments of your audio. So if you have an audio and it tells you what is the phonetic sequence of it, and so those are the targets, and also it tells you what frame belongs to what phone, right? So that's why it's a tied phone. Tied phone is basically two phones combined together, three phones combined together. So simple, you just say the thing is you have frames in your audio, and for each frame you have some label, right? And you optimize the neural network to predict those labels, right? Simple classification kind of model. So that is the baseline. And they also have some monophone level CTC model and character level CTC model. That is the architecture. And they have this RNN transducer, which is what is introduced in this paper. And they have some hierarchical CTC for pre-training method. Those things have some extra things. And prediction network is basically, you saw the encoder. Encoder is that. Prediction network is again a two-layer BLSTM model with some fully connected layer and these are 512 nodes in the joint network. So the joint network is a feed-forward neural network. And in the input, they use this frame slicing. So basically, frame slicing is about concatenating left and right context to make a single feature. So, and also they have applied skipping. Basically, skipping is about subsampling. Right? And they have used few tricks for efficient training. So basically, sharpen learning rate decay basically divides the learning rate by two or more. Actually, in this paper, they are saying they divide the learning rate by 10. Abandoned encoder pre-training is basically don't do pre-training of the encoder. And acceleration by subsampling means you have to fit your input data into a memory, GPU memory, which is maybe limited. Maybe in your case, you may have 12 GB or 16 GB or even 24 GB RAM, but the batch size should be, if you select batch size of 20, it should be able to fit into that particular GPU memory because it takes care of inactivity and all. This is the kind of problem people face always. So subsampling is basically reduces this problem. So if you subsample by two, you can actually double the size of your batch almost. And prediction network initialization. So these are some few tricks they have applied for efficient training. And coming to the model configuration, they have, as I said, the encoder is basically a CNN along with BLSTM. And the prediction network is a embedded layer with two LSTMs, and joint network is just a feed-forward neural network. Simple. And coming to the results, I am showing only two results. They have some results for other tricks, they have generated results for all those tricks I just told you. But you can just go through that paper in detail. I'll give the paper link in the description box. And if you see the results, this is the baseline, 18% baseline, it's good. Character based CTC gets you this much, phone level gets you this much, and RNN transducer gets little bit improvement, little bit, I mean not big, little bit improvement over normal baseline, the baseline model. And they have also evaluated the results based on the amount of audio data they have used, varied from 1000 hours to 10,000 hours. So obviously it clearly says if you increase the amount of training data, you will get huge improvement, right? And that's all for this tutorial. Thank you so much for watching this tutorial. If you're not subscribed to my channel, please subscribe. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. Thank you.